green or blue, blue or green, you must choose your colour, or maybe not. Well then, neither of the two is safer. You never know whom you might run into, especially on a day like today. You might only get a nasty remark, but it could be worse. It's an unwritten law here in Glasgow. In some parts of the city, it is not the colour of your skin that might get you into trouble, but the colour you are wearing around your neck.
The expression Glasgow colours takes me straight into the green and blue.
Celtic and Rangers supporters talk about the colours, they're talking about their team colours, you know, their scarves, their football jerseys.
Glasgow is all about football.
Two city rivals.
The Rangers-Celtic rivalry.
You show your colours.
You show your colours.
Show your colours, definitely. Rangers, it's everything.
The Rangers colours are red, white and blue, and the Celtic colours are green and white hoops.
You show your colours.
You show your colours.
Show your colours.
This place is deserted at the moment. It's lunchtime on Thursday, but in 2 days' time, Celtic play Rangers, and you won't be able to move for people and police and stewards on Saturday. But the place will just be awash with colour. There'll be green and white everywhere. There'll be red, white and blue. Up there in this section, most of the Rangers fans will come along here, London Road from Brixton Cross. Most of the Celtic fans will be coming up here, along from the other end. But it's a phenomenon. It's a fantastic, incredible cultural spectacle, an event, an Old Firm match. It really is incredible. As I say, 60,000 fans doesn't make it special. You could build a stadium that held 200,000 fans and still fill it. You would still feel it, but you would still get that same atmosphere.
Two very strong, significant football clubs.
Celtic.
Irish Catholic Football Club.
Rangers.
British Protestant Football Club. Both clubs in Scotland, both clubs in Glasgow.
Against Hearts.
I've never seen Rangers play well.
Did you not see the Hearts game when they won 3-1? Oh, have you not?
No, not in my eyes, not.
Oh, you're a Celtic guy?
In terms of media coverage in Scotland, I would say football would take up 90% within football. The Old Firm take up 90%. Of the interest there. They play each other four times a season, at least, often five, sometimes six. The name Old Firm comes from a business understanding between the two clubs at the beginning of the 20th century, when they were playing each other so often because they knew they could attract the big crowds. And there were suggestions at that point that they would deliberately draw games so they could have replays and get bigger crowds again. And it's been the same ever since, although probably in the last 20 years it's speeded up more. You know, there's been more commercialisation of football and selling of the tops and just marketing of football.
Ago, there was a guy standing at this bus stop, and he was attacked by another man, a young boy as well, and he was murdered. And recently in Glasgow, if you support Celtic or Rangers, the people who are coming to pay their respects, they will lay the colour of your team against where you died. So in Glasgow, you can go to different places and you see Celtic tops, Rangers tops, sometimes mixed.
And this is them up singing again when a Celtic do. And this is them all at Celtic.
That's Abby and Chloe.
Celtic Park, is it?
Yeah, Mum's
that
Abby
you?
And Chloe.
Mum, is that you?
Yeah.
And that was Antonio as a baby at one of his first games when he was just... Yeah. But that's Lizzie's book, Lisbon Line, John Clark.
No.
Same. So... History perpetuates itself one generation after another. The same things that happened to me, I now take them to do the same things, go and meet the players and be excited about these things.
Rangers till we die. Family, it's been passed down. My granddad to my dad to me, for me to my son. I've got a wee boy at 10, he's the same. Rangers daft. And that's just, if he was to turn out a Celtic supporter, I'd, oh, fuck. I couldn't handle it. It would break my heart so much, it would be unreal.
Football seems to me, it's totally different. You get so wrapped up in it, emotionally. It can be very emotional. You can find yourself crying when you win. You can find yourself crying when you're in a defeat. You can get very, very emotional in football. It's like a marriage.
It's the right colour anyway.
Well, it's like a second religion to us. We're Christians, first and foremost. And secondly, we're second religion, you could say. We love the Rangers.
Somebody who's got no interest in football might say, why do you support the green and white and somebody else supports the blue? What does it matter? We're all human beings or whatever. But I think it is bound up with culture, history, family, community, identity, your relationship with your father, a kind of generational thing. So I think it's, for that reason, I think it's complicated because it's a bundle of things that can't just be, you know, counted out or spelled out in a simple way.
Celtic on the left, Rangers on the right. It promised to be quite a match, and it was. The ball across for McNeil to head it home. Sensation! The Celtic defence was formidable, and tempers flared easily. But it was a clear-cut and well-deserved win by a fine team. The police had to move in and clear the pitch, but it was all over anyway.
when we look at Celtic and Rangers and the relationship between the both sets of fans, we really see a tremendous and bitter rivalry, which has been in existence for a long time. From the 1860s, 1870s, even into the 1880s. In Scotland, we refer to it as the football explosion.
Scotland, an industrial in those days, heavy industry, heavy engineering, coal, the shipyards, steelworks, and most of those guys, that would have been their life. If you could imagine 12 hours a day down underneath ground mining coal, and over the weekend that's what they got, that was what their joy they got, they're going to see the football.
Scotland experienced a major social and economic revolution during the 18th and 19th centuries. You have had a process of maybe 100 years of people being drawn away from the countryside and into the towns and cities as they really started to grow due to the Industrial Revolution. And that also affects football. Again, you look at Glasgow, which very quickly increased incredibly in terms of the size of population over a 100-year period. Really one of the most important aspects of the rise of Glasgow in terms of population is actually migration or emigration from Ireland.
Catholic community arrived in Glasgow in the late 1800s, about 1880s, and it was part of a result of the potato famine in Ireland. And what we had was economic immigrants, if you like, people leaving Ireland, going right across the world, looking for ways to support their family, looking for jobs, looking for work. And a large portion of that community arrived in Scotland and arrived in Glasgow and settled in the east end of the city, but were met by an indigenous population that weren't happy to see them. You have to bear in mind that Scotland had worked really hard in the Reformation and had wiped out all signs of Catholicism as best it could. And here we had a community coming to settle in the city that were unwelcome on two fronts. Firstly, they were Irish and therefore seen as different. Secondly, they were predominantly, though not all, Catholic, and they were seen to be bringing Catholicism back into the city. And at that point, if you'd wandered round Glasgow and went looking for work, it wasn't unusual to see signs that said, no Irish, no Catholic.
The Irish Catholic Catholics brought a whole new brand of Catholicism to Glasgow.
Yeah.
The things that the Irish did, you know, like, so even their wakes and everything, it was all different in Scotland.
Well, it would be, that's right.
Their traditions, their superstitions,
yeah,
things
that's
that,
right,
that
yeah.
Scottish people would say, oh, no, we're not superstitious.
That's
the
right.
Irish were superstitious
that's
about
right, yeah.
And they brought this brand. So even Scottish Catholics
that's
felt they were a wee bit better than
yeah.
Irish
uh-huh.
Catholics.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
that was even more
but
to do
even,
with Irish.
Even the work
yeah.
ethic, the
uh-huh.
people that came to Ganongad as well. I mean, there were people coming from Ireland to get a job and to change their name.
Well, I was brought up in Ganongad, which they called Little Ireland, because it was really all Irish people. It's a great place to be brought up, really. You know, that we didn't have anything. It was slums. It was a slum area, and we had nothing. But we had the most important things that we were brought up to believe. First of all, that our faith was the most treasured possession we would ever have. And the fact that we were Irish, I mean, I was brought up with Irish songs.
Skin colour.
Height, etc. You may be the same, but you're Protestant same. A Catholic same.
Protestant, Catholic.
Alright, enough! Might be the same race, but what about religion?
Religion.
St Mary's Church Hall, this is in the Carlton. It was in this church that Brother Walfred, who was a parish priest, came up with the idea of starting a football club to help feed the poor children in this area of Glasgow. Now that was about 160 years ago. Now the reason we've got all this building work taking place is because the roof has just caved in, right, because it's never been replaced in all that time. Hence the state here just now. But this, for Celtic supporters, is the foundation stone of which the club was founded on. Without this building, without the parish priest, Brother Walfred, and without the parishioners, Celtic would never have existed. It was volunteer labour for the parishioners inside this chapel that built the first two Celtic football stadiums. That community which today still supports the club, but the club has never been exclusively for Catholics or exclusively for Irish Catholics. The doors have always been open to anybody, no matter what religion you are or what colour you are. And it's always been that way right from the very beginning.
Rangers were a football club first in Glasgow, and then through the Celtic arrival and through Celtic being popular amongst the poor and the Catholics of the east end of Glasgow, Rangers being from the other side of the city, there has to be a rivalry there because of the way that two cultures are in the one city, but they're now using two different football clubs to celebrate the different cultures.
Picton. Protestant heartland, as you can tell by the flags out. I say Celtic Park is just up there, Celtic Park's just up the road. And as you can probably imagine, you don't get very many Celtic supporters walking through here going to the game, because 9 times out of 10 you'd probably end up fighting. They would go the other way instead of coming through here. This is Brigton. All the Celtic supporters and Celtic pubs in this area. But we don't call them Celtic, we call them the bad people. But if Celtic are at home, we don't get near it. You get up in the morning, you know you're a Rangers fan. It's a total way of life, it rules your life. It helps you get jobs, it stops you getting jobs. You can drink in certain pubs you can't. Certain areas you can go to, certain areas you can't. It's a total way of life.
Be simplifying it to say Irish Catholic Football Club, British Protestant Football Club, both clubs in Scotland, both clubs in Glasgow. But it is an amazing thing that if you go to a Celtic and Rangers match in Glasgow, in Scotland, you can see a lot of the stadium full of tricolours, the Irish flag, and a lot of and then the British flag, the Union Jack. You might not see many, pardon me, Scottish flags. So there is something about identity and about history and about national politics that's evident just through that, through Celtic and Rangers.
I mean, I would describe myself as having both identities, both Scottish and Irish identities. I'm equally proud of both, and equally comfortable with both.
Being Scottish means I'm British, and I'm very proud of both.
You don't have to be British to be a Rangers fan.
It's in your blood. That's it. You're born that way. And Rangers to a die. I just love being British.
And no matter who we support or where we go, the Queen, she's our Queen. She's
whether
the head
you like
of us.
It or not, she's our boss. Simple as that. That's the rules.
That's why she's got middle place in our bar in there.
99% of Rangers fans are very staunch British and love our Queen, our monarch. And that's what it means. Or this one here. This is one for Carrick Fergus. Willingly loyal, Northern Ireland. And this one's from Northern Ireland as well. There's nothing else there, is there? 100 years of Ibrox Stadium, that's us. At the centenary new Ibrox. William of Orange. He won the Battle of the Boyne and Gates of Derry. And I was going to say, he beat King James. This country would have been Catholic if it wasn't for him winning the Battle of the Boyne. He done it. That's why we're a Protestant country. Right, the pub will never change. It's a Glasgow Rangers pub. 99% of people that ring it are Protestant. But there's Catholics who support Rangers too. They know they're Rangers supporters, but they might have been different religion, but they're still Rangers fans, and they come and work here. So it's not just, oh, he hate everybody. That's not the case.
So we don't class ourselves as bigots, because we do employ and we do have friends of the opposite religion, and we don't class ourselves as bigots. We class ourselves as friends.
Kiss my boys! Oh, fuck, forgot.
Stephen!
He was shouting at me. Fenian bastard. Sorry. I'm up there. Sorry.
Like that was a Celtic fan.
I was a Celtic fan just shouting at me.
What did you say?
I'm on the hoops. 100 years old. Centenary. The 9 in a row team when we won 9 championships in a row. Alan McCoy's.
Testimonial.
Davey Cooper.
Rangers won the league 2 years ago.
The names on the wall.
Rangers won the Scottish Cup.
Richard Goff.
Mark Kelly.
Be offended by my flag or my culture. You come into my country, I should be entitled to fly it and be very patriotic and proud of it. And if I don't get to do that, it causes resentment, and that's where your racism comes from.
People always think intellect, literature, history, culture, anti-imperialism, political correctness are all on the side of Celtic. And Rangers get the Queen, the Empire, you know, and racism, and the National Front, and the British National Party. Celtic have got Che Guevara and Castro, and Rangers have got the Queen. It's not a fair contest. But I think that is an unfair characterisation. I think that's the stereotype, and there's definitely elements of truth in it. I mean, I believe something which is true. I believe that imperialism breeds a sense of superiority. And I believe that discrimination against immigrant communities comes out of that identification with the Crown and with Empire. So from that point of view, I think it's true that if you want support for the Empire, go to Rangers Football Club. If you want criticism of the Empire, go to Celtic Football Club. There was only two places in Europe where the Catholic vote was automatically socially progressive vote or a Labour vote or a radical vote. Was not conservative monarchist. And those two places are the west of Scotland and the north of Ireland.
The sense of Irishness has become very popular over the last few decades, which Celtic fans are very closely aligned to their Irish roots, if you like. Whereas in Scotland or in Britain, the sense of empire has been very negatively portrayed over the years. And Rangers fans have traditionally been linked with the British Empire.
I think the atmosphere around an Old Firm match is a phenomenal atmosphere. It is okay to be passionate about your football team. We're not about taking the passion out of football. The difficulty is, supporting your team is a fantastic thing. The problem arises when you cross over from supporting your team to hating the opposition. It's not the football rivalry, it's not the feeling of wanting your team desperately to win, but it's that absolute hatred of the opposition that I find very difficult to understand.
There's violence in the city centre every Saturday night, whether there's games on or not.
If there wasn't the football, there would still be the violence.
You can't just say because it's an Old Firm game there's violence in city centres. You get it every Saturday night.
Glasgow is a violent city.
I love it despite the fact that it's a city that's quite often had very poor housing, very poor facilities and lots of unemployment, people really living in conditions that they shouldn't have been living in. You hope it's getting better all the time, but you still think there have been schools getting closed and so on. There's a lot of things wrong with Glasgow. So I do think poverty, to me, is a crime. Alcoholism and anger and resentment and a sense of injustice, they can all bring out violence.
Alcohol goes behind most violence in Scotland, probably everywhere in the world, but certainly in Scotland, there's a tradition of violence associated with alcohol.
Some people might say that football keeps a lid on the violence because it ties up people's emotions into something solid and stable, like a football club.
Let me tell you another thing, though, why there is violence on the day of the Old Firm games. Because 30 years ago and before that, there would be no televised football, live televised football. So if you weren't at the game, you listened to it on radio, you didn't see it. Nowadays, all the games are televised live in pubs. So all the pubs are full of people drinking during the games, and there's always a spark there, possibly. And that's where you get most of the violence, is in the pubs and after the pubs close.
Someone who is exhibiting that type of behaviour in a football context has a more fundamental, a more deep-rooted attitudinal problem if they feel the need during a football match to sing songs which are, you know, derogatory to another group of people.
I don't see this particular issue of sectarianism as a predominantly working class issue. I think it manifests itself more in poorer areas. You'll see the graffiti, you'll see the fights breaking out, you'll see the violence. But equally, if you were to stand in a West End Glasgow bar talking to a group of very educated professional people, you will be amazed at what comes out of people's mouths. You will be amazed to hear that those people who are well educated, who should know differently, who join in the whole sectarian debate and think it's okay to use words and phrases that actually are offensive. And it's never questioned. So I don't think it is just a working class issue. I think it's wider than that. And I think if we are going to change it, all of that needs to be questioned.
Hush, hush. Can you hear the heartbeats? Newborn human, welcome to the
Very, very excited. Got the butterflies. Think about the game. Really excited. But, I don't think we'll do as well tomorrow as what we've been recently against Celtic. We can only live in hope what we'll do it tomorrow. Andy's a Celtic man, so I'm sure Andy will disagree with what I've been saying.
Well, I'm very confident about tomorrow. Very confident, I think.
I've never seen the Rangers with such a price. Yeah, 3-1 your cash, Rangers. Very, very big.
Big price in an old firm game. Big price in an old firm game.
I hope it goes trouble-free. The crowd behaved herself. David Murray's told the Rangers fans to cut out all this sectarian singing. So I hope they adhere to David Murray's comments. And I hope it's a good game. Kyle, this got my big straight edge.
I'm serious, sometimes it boils over. Some people they can't take it, don't they? It just boils over.
Yes. A lot of it's alcohol fueled as well.
Well, that's why the early kick-off is because of to try and keep the drunken culture away from the game, the early kick-off, don't they?
Yeah, well, I think they're succeeding over the last few years. There's not been a lot of violence. Most of it is away from the ground.
Ruin men, it'll totally ruin their weekend. I mean, if Celtic get beat, or on the other hand, if Rangers get beat, it'll not ruin your weekend, John, if Rangers get beat.
I wouldn't think so.
You know what I mean? Tag it on you on Monday.
Certainly. that'll ruin my weekend. Think of coming in here Monday.
That's true, you know what I mean? So that could spoil your weekend, but...
This is Ibrox. As Andy will probably disagree, he'll say Parkhead's a better stadium, but I would say this is over here. When I look out, it fills my heart with joy, thinking the Rangers are just over there.
Ready to jump over?
Monday morning, I maybe want to jump over if we get beat. So
Celtic and Rangers fan can be friends, they can work together.
Oh, yes.
Difficult on the day of the game, right?
On the day of the game.
Difficult on the day of the game because after that, it's no problem. Normally.
After the game, we shake hands and forget all about it till the next game, 2 or 3 days before it, and the run up to it.
I was a Celtic fan before I was born. I was just going to be a Celtic fan. My first Celtic game was when I was 9 months old. I have got one real best friend who supports Rangers, but even though the rivalry between the teams, we still got on great.
I met Antonio at the first day of school and we've been friends for 7 years. I support Rangers Football Club because my full family supported Rangers.
Yeah,
since
he was born a Rangers fan.
I was born a Rangers fan, really. I'm the only Rangers fan
in the class.
Everybody else supports Celtic
except one.
It's really, really annoying when I go in and Celtic beat Rangers, and it's really good
agitated
when Rangers beat Celtic because I can just slag everybody in the class.
Yep. Right, come
on. There's a lot of people in our school that do like him. You know, he's a Rangers fan and he's a Catholic. Nearly everybody in our school likes Jamie. Funny when if Rangers have beat Celtic the night or 2 nights before, and it's funny when I walk in school, they'd always walk the different direction, so I wouldn't say anything to them because they all know I'm a Rangers fan,
and they don't
everybody
want to get slagged,
in the school really
just walks away from them.
Celtic fans, though.
This is the Calton, that was my primary school. And this is where we used to play, we used to practice football and play at lunch times and practice time. And on the very hard surface, this is where I had to learn to play football. It looks very, very bad now.
These days now, the children can go to the same school, the Catholics and the Protestants, but then it was more strict. Because I was non-Catholic, though, I had to go to this school. I was the only Celtic fan in the school, and when Celtic were beaten, or all the time then, by Rangers, one time 5-1, the whole school circled me, or all the children, all the girls too, and they all shouted 5-1, 5-1, 5-1 at me, and I was in the middle of the circle, and I was at the match. It was my first match on the Saturday. This was the Monday morning, and I knew, obviously, I would get, slagged.
What?
Remember? The boys from Noble?
Oh, yeah, that happened to me once. Three boys in the Protestant school across the road from our school, and I was walking down the road down there, and because there's a shortcut we always take. I wore a green Celtic top, total green, and you could obviously tell it was Celtic. I walked down that road, three boys started to pick a fight with me.
And you
told me not to wear a Celtic top.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, no, I'll be all right. And I walked out and people started calling me Fenians.
Mm-hmm.
Started calling me Fenians.
Swearing at you.
Yep, mm-hmm. Swearing at me.
I was saying today, when we were at the school next to Antonio, there's a North Lanarkshire policy that you can't wear a Celtic or football colours, is it? Or is it just Celtic football colours? Any school because of trouble?
Standing beside Jerry.
If you wore a particular colour in a pub rather than just being a football supporter, you could be just a tourist or a visitor to the city, and you might wear a certain colour of one or the other, and you would be classed as, Rangers or Celtic, and I imagine so. It's led to some problems for people before.
The perception is, if you wear green or blue, that you're automatically put into a Celtic or Rangers category, even if you're not interested in football. You know, it just might be the fashion of the day, but that's the way the football people in the city perceive things, you know.
Some people, through naivety, might think that you can go anywhere you like wearing a Celtic scarf or Celtic colours, but you can't. You can't. It's not true. Yesterday, I saw a student outside in the street here with a Celtic top on. It wasn't a match day. And I thought, this is a student who'd just come here, perhaps from another place, and he thinks, this is a terrible thing to say, but it's true, he thinks that he's a student now, so you wear anything. So you can wear a Celtic top and walk around here in Glasgow completely freely, unmolested, unperturbed. It isn't true. He might wander into a place where that football top leads to him being injured or attacked or abused in some way. So I think it then becomes like a badge of pride and defiance, wearing your colours. It can be a source of distress, trouble, violence and so on. That's true.
You show your colours.
You show your colours.
Show your colours, definitely.
Rangers supporters are attacked or abused or shouted at or ridiculed for wearing colours. Celtic supporters, the same, depending on where you are. I mean, there'll be parts of the city, times of the day, times of the night, and parts of the city.
I remember a young chap walking back from Parkhead wearing his Celtic scarf or whatever it was, and one of these guys came out the pub at Bridgeton Cross, which is a predominantly Rangers, Protestant, Loyalist slight, if you like, area, and slashed the poor boy across the throat, and the boy died. So, for wearing a Rangers top or a Celtic top, it's not worth your life.
Some pressure groups would have you believe that in the past 10 years or so, there have been 11 sectarian murders in Strathclyde associated with Rangers and Celtic matches. Other sources would dispute this and say that the number is far lower. I think it depends on the parameters that you put on and the definition that you apply.
History is to blame, and that there's a history of colonisation and immigration which lies behind a lot of the antipathy between Celtic and Rangers. And I don't think you can solve history by stopping football supporters from singing certain songs or from feeling certain kinds of identification. I think it's the larger political structures that would have to be altered in some way in order for that animosity to end.
I mean, I've got tremendous hope for Glasgow. Glasgow is shifting and changing. And I think if we are going to create a different city, I think we have to invest our hopes in our young people. Young people question this all the time. Young people don't take it as read. And I think, from what I've seen in my work, we're in for a very positive future because those young people are looking for something different. Those kids came together from all across Glasgow and had to learn to work together and had to break down some of the barriers. And the musical they did was about exploring the issue of sectarianism, using music and drama as a way of questioning their values and attitudes.
Days time, Celtic play Rangers, and you won't be able to move for people and police and stewards on Saturday. The police will have to be, they're always on the watch to try and keep the fans separate on separate sides of the road. They'll be separated by what I call a no-fans land. It's quite an atmosphere. I mean, there's an awful lot of noise, an awful lot of singing. Colours and flags everywhere.
It's a part of your life. From my point of view, you want to try and be upstanding. And for people to look and say, that's John, he's a Rangers fan and he's a good guy. You don't want to be portrayed as a drunk and a thug and a hooligan. So again, if you're representing your family and your club. So to me, it's not just about being a football fan, it's about being upstanding, supporting your team and let the community know you're a decent guy and you're not involved in the sectarianism that goes on and the hate that rivals have for each other.
I'm a Celtic supporter second because of the football team, but I'm a Celtic supporter first because of the people who I can have friendships with, and Celtic is a great football club, but more than that, it's a vehicle for people to celebrate being one of the same.
We listen, but we don't hear. We talk, but we don't communicate. We fight and we die. Why?
I think football is political anyway. It's a mass participation, mass audience sport. And yeah, I think it is one of those places where people can prominently display their cultural identity, their history and so on.
Thank you.